don't know about you, but that song right there, I added it to my playlist.
I like that song.
I've been using it in the morning, give my prayer in the morning, man.
It's good.
Tell me that, that song right there, it just breaks it. It breaks you, man, because this presence of the Lord just comes and it's just like, wow. The Lord's moving. You know, once again, thank you everybody for came out tonight, everybody joined us on Facebook Live. And I hope that tonight I can share a word that maybe that can speak to somebody's heart.
Amen.
If it just reaches somebody, just one person tonight,
that's right.
God, that's God.
Amen.
So,
hallelujah.
You know, that song, like I said, you know, it's, Lord saved me. You know, He saved us. You know, and the title of my sermon was it was death to life. How we went from being dead, but yet when Jesus went to the cross for us, He shed that blood for us.
Amen.
He gave us new life.
That's right, amen.
See, because through one man we were sentenced to death, but through another man we were given life.
Amen.
When I say that, I mean by the first time, the first person to sin was who? Adam. And through the sin of the disobedience that came with him disobeying God by not listening, don't eat the fruit from the tree. That was when sin first crept into our hearts. That's when we became, it was death. You know, so through Jesus Christ, the Bible tells us that the wage for sin is death. If you go to Romans 6, 22 and 23, it'll tell you, but now that we have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the benefit we reap leads to holiness as the result in eternal life.
Amen.
For the wages of sin is death, but the gift is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Thank you.
See, it says right there that, you know, the wages for sin is death, but what Jesus did for us on the cross, and He's given us eternal life.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
You see, though we inherited and we were born into sin, we don't have to stay that way.
That's right.
You know, God loved us so much that He gave His only Son on the cross so that we didn't have to stay that way. You know, sin is what we do, it's not who we are.
Amen.
And it's what we choose to do or choose not to. But it's a hard thing to do if you don't have a relationship with Jesus. Say that right now. It's impossible. You know, I've learned in my walk with the Lord that it's hard. It's a hard thing to do. I cannot do it on my own.
Amen.
That's why I get up every morning and I pray every morning and I say, Lord, you know what? Let Your will be done in my life.
Amen.
Because I need Your strength to get through today. You know, just Thursday mornings that I get up in the morning and it's hard for me to pray. It's hard for me to open up my word. I have those days.
Amen.
I'm sure we all do.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying? But, you know, I thank the Lord that I still get on my knees. I still open up the word. You know, because if I try to walk out that door and go to work in the morning, man, we can be fleshy. I can be fleshy. You know what I'm saying? And I know when I don't do what I'm supposed to do is spend my time with God, spend my time getting to prayer in the morning, reading my word. You know, I already know how my day is going to go.
Amen.
You know, it's like the first person that I talk to in the morning.
Yep.
You know, it's rough. But, you know, if we do what we're supposed to do, and we spend the time with the Lord, we ask the Lord, hey, you know, today, let Your will be done in my life. Allow me to decrease so You can increase. That's the one thing I share. That's the one thing that I make sure every day that I share. Lord, allow me to decrease so that You may increase.
Amen.
That today that I glorify You in everything that I do. You know what I'm saying? No matter how bad the situation, no matter how bad the circumstance, You're glorified.
Amen.
Lord, I thank You for every trial because through the trials, I'm learning Your teaching. You know what I'm saying? So, like I told you, we don't have to stay that way. See, but we do have a choice.
Amen.
We do have a choice to either obey God or not obey God. He loved us that much. You know, He loved us that much that He gave us a choice. You know, how do we want to live our lives? You know, do we want to live our lives and serve the Lord, live our lives and glorify Him in everything that we do? You know what I'm saying? Or do we want to live worldly? Trust me, I've tried the worldly thing. It doesn't work. How many years I've tried the worldly thing? It doesn't work.
Doesn't work.
Doesn't. You know? And it's not easy. It's not easy to separate your walk with the Lord. And, you know, sometimes we want to do them both. You know what I'm saying? But it doesn't work that way. We can't have both worlds. You know what I'm saying? We can't. And then I believe it's Matthew 7:21-23. I'll mix these up. Yeah, Matthew 7. Is that the one? Not everyone who says, "Lord, Lord," will enter the kingdom of heaven. But only the one who does not. The only one who does the will of the Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on the day of the Lord, "Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles?" Then I will tell you, I will tell them plainly, "I never knew you. Away from me, evildoers." See, we want to go out into the world and we want to live the world and live in a worldly way, but at the same time we want to say that we have a relationship with Jesus. We can't do that. You know? Can you imagine when you stand in front of Jesus or in front of God and the Lord, and on judgment day, and he tells you, away from me, evildoer, I never knew you? Man, I couldn't imagine having that sentiment, thinking to myself, well, I did everything that you asked me to do. I did everything that you told me to do. But did I do it with a kind heart? Did I do it to glorify God, or did I do it to glorify myself? Did I do it to advance the kingdom of God, or did I do it to get pride and puff my chest? You know? I want the Lord to know my heart.
Amen.
I want him every morning as I pray, "Lord, search my heart. If there's something in my heart that separates me from you." And like I said, sin and death, sin, the way you say, if there's any sin in my heart, it's going to separate me from you. See, when we have sin in our life, it drives a wedge. It drives a wedge between us and God. You know what I'm saying? Because it separates. So I ask the Lord every morning, "Lord, if there's anything in my heart, anything, any hatred, any pridefulness, or any kind of thing that's going to cause division in my life with somebody, or I'm angry with somebody, or someone's frustrating me, I don't want to walk around with that in my heart." Because guess what? That separates me from the grace of God that day as I go to work. It separates me and allows me not to walk in God's grace, but to walk in the worldly manner. And guess what? That's not a good thing when we do that. It's not a good thing at all. You know, there's a price that we have to pay. There's a price that we pay. You know what I'm saying? And I know many times that we go to church, I mean, it's been a while since I've heard it, but there is a heaven and there is a hell, no?
Amen.
There is a heaven and there is a hell. There is a consequence for our sinful ways. You know what I'm saying? There's a consequence for us allowing the Lord to be in our lives and change our hearts, to do our best to represent Jesus on a daily basis.
Amen.
To represent Jesus the best that we can. There's a consequence. Either we choose to live in a worldly way, or we choose to live in a godly way, a holy way. Do our best. That was already broken. So, Pastor Norman, if he's out there, that was already broken. I think I heard it last week when he said that. So anyways, like I was telling you, there's a consequence. See, a lot of people, I don't think that we talk about heaven and hell too much. To be honest, when's the last time we heard a sermon about heaven and hell? I think it scares a lot of people.
Amen.
It does. It scares a lot of people. But I would rather people be scared to know the truth.
Amen. Amen.
Or, you know, it's not always going to be rainbows and butterflies.
That's right.
It's not always going to be what we want to hear, you know what I'm saying, what makes us a feel-good message.
Amen.
You know, and that's why I went like Pastor Bobby. You know, and everybody always says Pastor Bobby's real, you can be real intimidating. You can be real, you like to spit, you like to get into it. You like to, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know, I love that about Pastor Bobby.
Yeah.
Because he didn't sugarcoat it.
Right.
He told me what I needed to hear. He told me, even out of church, me and Pastor Bobby, all you all know, he's my compa. So I can go to him and I can tell him what he's doing and he can come to me, but I like it that way. I want to be held accountable.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying? And us, we need that accountability in our lives. That's why I tell you, it can't always be rainbows and butterflies. You know, there is a heaven and there is a hell. If we choose to sin and live a worldly way, not have anything to do with Jesus, not accept him as our Lord and Savior, say we don't want nothing to do with you, guess what? Where are we going? Hell, I'm sorry. You know, and even, I know I mixed these papers up. I was nervous as I was coming. I'm not going to lie.
It's okay.
Matthew 13, 49, 50. This is, comes out of Jesus' mouth. This is what Jesus, if you go up in the Bible, you go to Matthew, it's read. And in the Bible, we all know when it's read, Jesus is speaking to us. Right?
Amen.
And this is how it will be at the end of age. The angels will come, and they will separate the wicked from the righteous, and they will throw them into the blazing furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of the teeth. To me, that sounds like hell, no?
Yes, sir.
And that's not no place I want to go. That's not no place I want to experience. You know what I'm saying? Because on the other end, Jesus went to prepare a mansion.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Streets of gold. You know, that's what I want to experience. That's where I want to be. I don't want nothing to do with gnashing of the teeth and furnace of fire or nothing like that. See, but we have a choice to make. See, that's a choice that we have. We can either choose to go there or choose not to go there. See, we all know the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. We know that he went to the cross, was nailed to the cross, died 3 days later, he rose, defeated death on our behalf. You see, like I told you, sin, the wage of sin is death. But what Jesus did for us on that cross, he defeated. So we no longer have to deal with that, because Jesus took that for us. He paid that penalty for us. So we no longer have to worry about that. We can go to him each and every day and say, Lord, forgive us for the sin that we commit. Lord, forgive us for, you know, whatever we need to be forgiven. Whatever's in our hearts. Whatever's separating us from you today, Lord, forgive us. What a gift. God loved us that much. He loved us that much. You know, me, I've been serving the Lord for a couple of years now, like, you know, consistent, you know, and getting in prayer and praying and just getting into my word and learning more and more, you know what I'm saying? I ask Lord, you know, like I told you, I can't open up the Bible and tell you exactly where this is at, what scripture this is, where it's located, what page it's on. I'm not there. I'm not even close to being there. You know what I'm saying? But through my walk and through the faith that I have in Jesus and trusting in him and knowing what Jesus did for me, did for you, each of us on the cross, you know, I've given my life over to him. And I've said, look, it all belongs to you. All of it. I don't want any of that world. I don't want anything to do with the world anymore. You know, people are probably going to tell me, well, you think you're better than us, or you think you're this, that. That's fine. You can say all you want to say. You know, I'm choosing to serve my Father, my God, my Lord, my Savior. You know what I'm saying? But I can share it with Brother Nick. You know what I'm saying? In doing that, no one can tell me that God is not real.
Amen.
You want to know why? My daughter, my son, my sister-in-law, a new family friend, her first time here.
Amen.
A couple years ago, that wasn't the case. You know, my wife would be here. My wife would be here, but she goes to school.
Yeah.
Long hours. She doesn't get out until 8. So she wanted to be here, but she just couldn't. But she would be here. I see God moving. I see what he's doing because I've made him the priority of my life. Yeah. I've made him number one in my heart. He's my first love. It has to be that way. And I know it sounds weird. And a lot of people be like, what? No, God has to be first.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying? There's an order to things. God, wife, family, everything else comes.
Amen.
You know, and until we get it right, until we figure it out and understand that that's the way it has to be.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Things are not going to line up with you. They're not. You know what I'm saying? And look, I put the Lord first. You know, one of my prayers is, Lord, teach me to love you first.
Amen.
Because when you allow me to love you the right way, and you first, then you allow me to love everybody else the way they're supposed to be. I can't love anybody if I don't love God.
Amen.
I can't love myself if I don't love God. I don't know what that is. God, there's a love that God has for each and every one of us that we will never understand.
Amen.
I want to know that. But I will never know that unless I open up my heart to the Lord and tell you, Lord, you have to be the priority.
That's right.
You have to be the priority. Forgive me if I get a little teary because that's where I'm at right now in my walk with God. You know, I've gotten to the point where I need to share this because it's very important for us men here. For us men. You are the priests of your homes. You are called to lead your homes.
Amen.
I think I've been doing it for maybe 2 months now. Maybe 2 months now. And the Lord told me, you need to pray for your family. Every morning, my daughter, she'll call me or I'll call her. You know, but I make it a point that even if I'm at work and she's at home getting ready for Zoom, we're FaceTiming on the phone. Every day.
Amen.
And I need to tell, I instill in her, we need to make sure the first thing that we do in the morning is talk to the Lord.
Amen.
So I pray for her. Lord, just get her day going. Cover her. Watch over her.
That's right.
Amen. And then I started doing it with my wife. My wife, she also Zooms at work. So she gets on the desk, and before she Zooms on with her students, the first thing she does is call me. And I call her, or I call her. And I do the same thing for her. See, men, that's our job. That's what God has asked us to do. You know what I'm saying? He gave us our families, and we are to do this. We are to set the example for our children. How are they going to grow up and have a relationship with the Lord if we never show them this? If we never show them that they can pray to God and go to God and, you know, ask him for things and he's going to provide the things that we need. Maybe not the things that we want, but the things that we need. You know what I'm saying? It's very important. So parents, mothers, if you hear there isn't a dad, hey, you do it. You know, God has given us our children. They're not ours. They're his. He just entrusted us to teach them the right way. You know, so that's the most important thing. When I started doing that in my life and in my walk, man, I see God moving. I see him moving. I see his hand moving. I hear him speaking to me more. Like I told you guys today, I took a couple of days and Pastor Norman said, hey, Sam, I'm going to be going on vacation for a little bit. Do you think that you can cover here for me on a Wednesday? No problem, Pastor. I'll take care of you. But in the back of my mind, I was like, man. Stomach, butterflies, all that, right? So last week I just started, you know, I opened up a word, I did some prayer, and I'm like, Lord, lead me where you want me.
Amen.
So I, 3 or 4 days, my daughter would come in the room like, Dad, are you still writing? She's like, man, you've been here forever. And the next morning she gets up, I said, look, I stay and went to sleep yet, but I was praying. So I still went to sleep, I was up all night, still writing. It was like 4 or 5 pages, you know. I'm not very good at this stuff. But as I was at work, like I said, I was praying this morning and just... How many of you have ever been in that place with the Lord where he's just constantly talking to you?
That's right.
That's a good place to be. And right now, I'm there. And I thank you, Lord. I'm there. And it feels good because all day he was just talking to me and I was thinking, okay, I got you. So I got off at 1:30 this afternoon, and I went straight upstairs to the room, sat me on the computer, boom, I started typing again, and he just changed the whole subject. You know, so he changed the whole subject. And he needed me to talk to you guys about the importance it is, because I really don't think people these days take it serious when it comes to having a relationship with the Lord. You know, you get people to say, oh, I believe in God. I believe in Jesus. But then that's where they stop. They don't go no further. See, he's asking us to do more than that. He's asking us to live for God, to live for Jesus. Because when we start living for Jesus, then we actually start living. He starts living through us. You know what I'm saying? And we start to see his hand move. We start to see him doing things that we never thought were possible. Doors begin to open. Jobs begin to happen. You know, families begin to be mended. And I thank the Lord for that also, because you know what? Pastor Norman knows. My wife shared with him the situation that I had going on with my family. And I won't get too deep in it, but there was a situation that was going on. And all I could do was, Lord, pray. I know that you're going to cover. I know you're going to fix it. I know you're going to mend it. You know, and I know it's going to be good. But I have to trust that you're going to do it. I can't do it, so I didn't pick the phone up. I didn't do any of that. I just left it in the Lord's hands. And I said, Lord, you be in control of it. You know, I prayed for my wife because there was a situation that needed to be prayed for then. You know, I have another older daughter, and I prayed for a situation that needed to be done there. You know, I could have easily stepped in and said, hey, look, this is what it's going to be. You know, this is my daughter, you're my wife, this is how it's going to go, this is my son, you know, this is my daughter, this is how I want it to go. I could have done that, but I think I would have made it a lot worse. I wouldn't have made it no better. So what did I do? I just got on my knees and I prayed. Every day, prayed every day. I just say, man, it's good to be able to have my whole family in the house together. My grandkids. Going back to church, I had my grandkids there. You know, my kids were there. You know, we could sit there and I see his hand moving.
Amen.
Amen.
I see his hand. But that's not because I'm saying it, but it's because I'm being obedient. I'm putting him first. I'm allowing him to be in control. You take the steering wheel, I know, because if I take the steering wheel, we're going to fly on the side of the road. That's just the way it is. Right? So it's very important that people, that you make sure that the Lord has to be. I know, hey, I'm married. I've been married for, it's going to be 22 years on Saturday. And my wife understands that God comes first. My kids understand that God comes first. It wasn't easy for them to understand that. I still think at times they may think, hey, man, kind of overdo it. When it comes to God, I kind of overdo it. Because he didn't overdo it for me. Right? He went far and beyond for me. He went far and beyond for each of you. Could you imagine your only son being put on a cross for some stranger you don't even know? That's what he did. Is it going to be so hard for me to say, well, you're not asking very much of me? Submission, obedience, faithfulness, time with me. If I do all those things, what? He's going to give me my heart's desires?
Amen.
Really?
Amen.
Is that really hard to do?
No.
I don't think so. But people will make it seem like it's hard. They will. Because that world is tempting, huh? That world is a tempting place. And that's the sin in our lives. That's what we inherited from what Adam chose to do. You know what I'm saying? We were born into that. You know what I'm saying? But that's not what we have to be. And like I told you, we can't serve two places. We can't serve the world and we can't serve the Lord. It just doesn't work. Matthew 6:24. Jesus said, this was read again. You know what I'm saying? I was praying, he gave me a scripture, opened it up. Like I told you, when it's read in the Bible, Jesus is speaking to you, right? No one can serve two masters. Either you hate one and you love the other, you will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God, and it says, and money. I'm going to say you cannot serve God and the world. It doesn't work. It's like oil and water. It doesn't mix, right? You can't serve them both. And I know one of the hardest things for us to do is to let go of the world. You know what I'm saying? We don't want to let go. We think that if we let go of them, then who are we? What are we going to do? You know what I'm saying? Who are we going to lose? That's another thing. Who are we going to lose? My friends are going to disappear. You know what I'm saying? No one's going to speak to me. Hey, God speaks to me. I'm good with that. You know? Things are going to change. I'm not going to lie to you. If I don't tell you that, then I'm not telling you the truth. People will come into your life and people will go into your life. If God takes someone out of your life because you're serving the Lord and you belong to Him and your heart belongs to Him, and if God takes someone out of your life, guess what? He's going to bring someone into your life who's going to sit there and help you in your walk. He's going to help you. He's going to send somebody there to help you. He's going to surround you with people like this. Would I rather be at a bar drinking, or would I rather be here in church with my brothers and sisters worshiping, praying, and sharing the word with you? Man, that's where I'm at right now. I would rather be here. This is a good time for me. I know it's not a good time for the young ones and the little ones. You got to drive them to church. You know, I know how that goes. I did it. You know what I'm saying? I did it. My mom, they dragged me. You're going to live here in this house. You're going to go to church. That lasted for a while. And I fought it. And I bumped heads. And I did it. And I said, Brother Nick, you know, that happened. But if that didn't happen, they wouldn't have done that. I don't think I would be here now. I don't think that I would be sharing the word with you now if I wouldn't have, you know, if they wouldn't have instilled that in me. Introduce me to God. Introduce me to Jesus. Introduce me to the word. Introduce me and say, hey, you know, you're going to do this. You're going to do this. I try it with my kids. Trust me, I do. You know, hey, if you don't go on Wednesday, you are going to go on Sunday. My son, he doesn't live with me no more, so I tell him, hey, that's your choice. You know what you want. I did my job. I told you. I prayed with you. I prayed with you. And I did this with you. I might have started it late in his life, and I asked God to forgive me for that. Because, you know what, I'm not perfect. I made a mistake. You know, I by the time I started serving the Lord again, he was already 15 years old. It was new to him. He knew the old me. He knew the me that, hey, son, go get me a beer out of the ice chest. Hey, son, he knew that person. He knew the dad who was passed out of, man, those are things that I cannot erase from his memory. Those are things that, the memory that he had, that is not his fault, that is my fault. I can't erase the things that I did. So, yeah, it was new to him. You know, so the last couple of years, I tried to instill it. Now he's old enough. Now it's him. But I still have my little girl. She still belongs to me. She still lives with me. She's in my home. So guess what? She didn't go to church on Sunday. So, hey, but hey, I finally have you on Wednesday. Because guess what? I get to share the word.
Amen.
You get to see Dad share it. So these are the memories that I want my kids to have.
Amen.
You know, I don't want my kids to have memories of me passed out drunk.
That's right.
I gave that to him. And I can't take that. I can't change that. You know what I'm saying? I want my kids to have memories of Dad up here speaking, sharing God's word. You know what I'm saying? Of Dad praying for me in heaven. Of Dad doing his best to be a godly man. His best. I'm going to fail. We all are. But to have those memories and say, look, man, My dad was a godly man. He prayed for my family. He prayed for me. He prayed for my mom. He prayed for my brother. You know what I'm saying? He led my brother. So, because I started serving the Lord and I got to do that with my own. I got a brother now who's an ordained pastor.
Amen.
I got another brother. I got another brother who was, you know, a devoted Catholic. Hey, my brother got baptized and now he's serving the Lord at another church. But guess what? He's serving the Lord.
Amen.
He's starting to understand, you know what I'm saying? There's more to this than just saying, I believe in God. No, you know what? He's living for the Lord now. You know, my mom's serving the Lord. You know, I know my family's there. It's just good for me. It's just good to share that my sister-in-law, too. You know what I'm saying? But that's just because of what we do. You know, the example that we're setting. And like I said, parents, that's the example that we need to set for our kids, for our grandchildren. And I get to take my grandson to church on Sundays now.
Amen.
Man, that's a blessing in his own. Now he's getting a little bit of dose of the word, a little bit of dose of the children's church, and that's something that he loves it. You know, but that's because, guess what, I chose to serve. It all began somewhere, right?
Amen.
It's got to begin somewhere.
Amen.
It's got to begin with us. It's got to begin with you. It's got to begin with you. It's got to begin with me. No one else can do it. And we can't do it, like I said before, we can't do it on our own. You know what I'm saying? Like I told you, the testimony that I just gave about my family being together and just, you know, being able to share Sundays and my grandchildren being there, you know, I couldn't have done that on my own. But guess what? That's because I chose to step out of the world and chose to say, okay, Lord, now you're in control. You're number one. You're the most important thing.
Amen.
My message isn't going to be too long. It's already going to be 7:30. It's not going to be too long tonight. So. But like I got to share with you guys earlier about John 3:16, the other one I gave you, right? We all know this one. This is the most famous one. It's on t-shirts, it's on tattoos, everywhere. You know what I'm saying? It's a famous one. But I really don't think, I see the world now, like, you know, I really don't think that they really dive into the importance of it. You know? For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. Like I told you earlier, can you imagine giving up your only son for a stranger that you didn't even know? That you didn't even know? That whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Perish.
Thank you, Lord.
Perish. To die. To lose one's life. To suffer death. That's what the word perish means. Everlasting. But to have eternal life, everlasting life, endless, never ending. See, remember I told you in the beginning that the wage for sin was death? You know what I'm saying? And we no longer have to pay that price. Jesus prayed that for us.
Amen.
And when we accept the Lord in our hearts, accept the Lord in our lives, and we say, okay, Lord, my life belongs to you. You're in control. You take control. It's yours, no longer mine. Then we get that gift of eternal life. We get the eternal life. Can you imagine what eternal life looks like? Put a rope on that one, a rope on that one. You get a little piece over here. This is your life. The rest of that is eternal life. Everlasting. All I have to do is accept the Lord Jesus Christ into my heart, into my life, and say, Lord, I believe that you went to the cross for me. I believe that you died and you rose on the third day. I believe that you're sitting at the right hand of the Father. I believe that you shed that blood for me on the cross so that I could have eternal life. That's when it starts to be good. I'm telling you, the Lord starts moving, the Lord starts working. So no one can ever tell me, like I told you, that God's not real, that God's not real. I see it working. I see him working in my life. He can do the same thing for you. You know, some of us maybe struggle with things. I know we do. I know it's hard. I know it can be difficult at times. But you don't have to do it alone. know, I just explained to you that Jesus is there.
Amen.
You don't have to do it alone. So before I close tonight, like I said, it wasn't going to be very long tonight, but it was just a word that I think that somebody needed to hear.
Amen.
That you don't have to do it by yourself. You know what I'm saying? You don't have to do it by yourself. You know, Jesus wants to walk beside you. He wants to hold your hand. He wants to be a part of your life. You have to be a part of your life. You can't play with this is not a game to play. It's life or death. Right? It's life or death. You know, people, and I don't think that we drive that down enough when it comes to, you know, sometimes we learn, I don't think we drive it down enough. It's life or death. You know, and until we start looking at it that way, you know, I don't think that we're going to, you know, we as, going to take the seriousness. This is how important it is. You know, I need my kids to understand that, hey, man, you know, this is life or death. I don't mean to scare nobody. I don't mean to do any of that. I don't. But like I said, I'd rather tell you the truth and be real with you than sugarcoat it and make it butterflies and rainbows.
Amen.
Right? All right, so are we close tonight? If anybody needs any prayer, I know Brother Tommy on
Friday.
Friday night, yeah, let me know. We can all pray for you, know, just keep Brother Tommy and I.
Yes, amen.
In our prayers, we have a procedure done. We ask that the Lord guide the hands of the doctor and everything runs smoothly.
Amen.
You know,
amen.
He comes out of it nice and better than the way that he went in.
Amen. Amen.
So what we'll do is we'll go ahead and close in prayer, and then we'll get a worship song on, and I can pray for anybody who wants prayer. I don't mind. Alright? Alright, so Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, for tonight's word. I thank you, Heavenly Father, for the opportunity, Lord, that you've given me, Lord, to speak on your behalf, Heavenly Father. I don't know, Lord, if someone needed to hear this. I don't know if someone's going to walk out with this message, Heavenly Father, and to change their heart or help them in any way, Lord. If it did, Lord, I thank you for allowing me to be the vessel that you use. Lord, I thank you just for everybody coming out tonight, Lord, and just being able to have the opportunity to come up here and share this word, Lord. We pray for our pastor, Pastor Norman and Sister Stacy, Lord, as they're on vacation.
Yes.
We pray that you just keep your hand upon them.
Yes.
Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for them, Lord, Father. We thank you, Lord, for them being a blessing in our lives.
Yes.
And I just thank you once again for everybody who joined us here on Facebook and here at the church, Lord. We thank you today, Lord, and we just